Good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming. Thanks for being patient and hanging out. Hopefully everybody got a snack and something to drink. My name is Josh Kuhn. I'm a director of the Popular Music Project at the Norman Lear Center, and I teach here in the Annenberg School. And I'm going to be joined tonight by my esteemed colleague, Taj Frazier. We're going to have a chat with J.Period. I'll tell you a little bit real quick about what Popular Music Project is for those of you that don't know about it. All the info is at usc.edu/PMP. And the goal of Popular Music Project is to create spaces just like this one that function as ways of creating conversations about popular music that connect a campus like USC with a city like Los Angeles. And the goal is to figure out how to have ways to talk about pop music that connects us instead of separates us. And we do everything from events like this to research projects to artists in residence who work with undergraduate and graduate students from the music industry and beyond and develop projects and work on solving, trying to solve some of the questions of the music industry. We all know how that's going. Not so well. Lots of things to be solved. I would encourage any of you who are interested in popular music and interested in exploring some of these things to go to the website, join our mailing lists, and come to our events, check out what we do. Tonight is a really good example of the kinds of things that we do. I'm supposed to tell you that if you are live tweeting this, because I know you all are, especially I know Marcus is, live tweet, hashtag PMP is what I'm supposed to say. And we were debating whether you say hashtag. But you say hashtag. We have to sound like we're on it. So hashtag PMP. So earlier this year, I was listening to a mixtape that I didn't know where it came from. I didn't know who made it. And it was a pretty, I think, singular mixture of elements. It had some Kanon. And all of a sudden, I was listening to Kanon. And I was like, okay, that's Kanon. I get it. And then all of a sudden, it was Bob Dylan with Kanon, and then all of a sudden it was Bob Marley with Dylan and Kanon, and then it was all three of them with Fela. And suddenly Bob Dylan songs were becoming Kanon songs, and Kanon was singing with Bob Marley, and Fela was singing with Kanon. And in between songs that I'd never heard mashed up like that before were snippets of news footage, were snippets of speeches, were little interludes with Kanon talking about issues of being a messenger, being a prophet, what social justice means, all kinds of issues flowing in and out. And it was one of the most remarkable things I'd ever heard. And I looked, and it was by this guy, J.Period, and I didn't know who he was. And I looked him up, and lo and behold, I was very late to the game. And he had been doing some incredible mixtape work for all sorts of folks for a long, long time, like Lauryn Hill, Roots, Mary J. Blige, Q-Tip, B.I.G., Nas, and two volumes of Michael Jackson mixes that we'll be talking about, all this kind of stuff. So I was just kind of happily along my way, getting deep into the J.Period archive, not knowing anything more about him, that there was this person named J.Period. And then I found out that he's actually not a New York guy, but an L.A. guy. And more so found out that he's the nephew of yes. Bill Phillips, who ran a store in Boyle Heights from the 1930s up through the 1980s called the Phillips Music Company. That was the main music store and record store in the Boyle Heights neighborhood. And in fact, that you bought your first saxophone.
That's true.
From your Uncle Bill at the store. And I had been doing this project on the Phillips Music Company looking at the way that that store was a kind of emblematic of the blending of cultures and politics and worlds in East Los Angeles. And lo and behold, this is where you, like so many other folks in the music world today, Los Lobos and many others included, bought your first instruments there. And all the pieces started coming together, and then I was able to connect about this with the Phillips family themselves, who are here tonight, and they said, oh, he's part of the family. He's a Phillips, J.Period. And so we connected, and I met him in New York, and we just shared stories, and I learned a lot. And I'm really thrilled. That's how we all got here today. So I'm really thrilled that you're here and you're willing to share these stories. Definitely. With you. So I wanted to start by kind of just asking the basic question that I asked you in New York, which was how you went from being an LA boy, and to becoming a hip hop mixtape DJ in New York, and not just a hip hop mixtape DJ, but one of the leading.
I mean, the sort of no short way to tell that story, because it's definitely been a long, circuitous route towards doing this for a living. But for me, I think like my love affair with hip hop started with Beat Street. You know, I don't know if anybody in here even knows about Beat Street, but when I was maybe in first grade, it came out. It's a movie that you know, shows sort of the place in New York where hip hop came from, and it's all about, you know, break dancing and graffiti and hip hop, and I just fell in love with it. And I used to seek out these New York hip hop, you know, songs and albums and so forth all throughout growing up, and ended up, you know, compiling a really great collection of music. So much so that when I left and went to college, I went to Stanford. They would just ask me, my friends would ask me to play parties because I just had the best collection of music. And one of those parties that I played, which is literally in my freshman dorm, with, you know, two like disc men and a mixer, like it was a very, you know, rudimentary setup. I got heard by someone at the party who asked me to do their party off campus. And it turned out that that party was attended by basically all of the black, you know, sorority and fraternity brothers and sisters at Stanford. And I then had, you know, sort of launched a career DJing all these parties at Stanford. But it was really just a hobby. And then after I graduated, I studied basically multicultural psychology at Stanford, which was leading me to no job in particular. And I had done artwork since I was a little kid, and I decided to go to New York and try and do graphic design. And while I, you know, when I came to New York, was sort of at this moment where the bubble, I guess, of the internet was just sort of starting. And I got hired by a very small company where I was taught, you know, computer graphics and stuff like that. And about a year after that happened, people started using audio, you know, on the internet. And it really was the first time. And no one else at the company was interested in that. And I was very interested. So I started asking, you know, a couple of the techie guys to teach me, you know, some of the audio programs. And, you know, it was that combined with, you know, when I went to New York, I decided I was really gonna, you know, learn how to DJ properly. And I had met some people, a guy by the name of DJ Scribble. I don't know if anybody in here knows who that is, but I had met him, and he actually took me to get my first set of Technics 1200 turntables. And it was this chain of events where I had a party to celebrate getting my turntables. And at the party was, you know, a friend of a friend who heard me and said, "Oh, I'm having my birthday party next week. Can you DJ my birthday party?" And then I went and I did that, and then the bar owner heard me and he said, "Oh, you know, what are you doing every Friday night?" And I started, you know, DJing this sort of side, you know, thing separate from my job. And when the sort of bubble burst, you know, in New York, and all of the internet companies that had hired up tons of people went out of business, I literally had, you know, 6 months worth of unemployment checks and, you know, this, you know, two night a week DJ thing going. And step by step, it just turned, it started with me just really wanting to follow my passion. And there have been a lot of, you know, crazy aligning of the stars moments doing this, you know, such as the fact that CD burning technology also really became widespread around the time that I was, you know, starting to do this in New York. And so I started burning my own CDs. And I did this when I was a kid. I actually used to, you know, make what were called pause tapes, where I would record songs off the radio and, you know, mix them together in a really crude way. And, you know, with my turntables and with these, you know, CD burners, I started making these mixtapes. And it was literally like after work hours going and using the $10,000 fiery printer to print out my covers, cutting them out myself, and taking them to stores around New York. And it just was one of those things where I would take them to stores, and if they liked them, I would go back and bring more, and started learning about how this worked, because there's really a whole ecosystem of mixtapes, or at least there was at that time in New York. And I started doing that, and then the real launch pad came in 2003 when a friend of mine was invited to a listening session for a Nas album, which was called Godson at the time. And he couldn't go, and he gave me his ticket in his place to go. And I was there, and it was all of these college radio DJs, which I was not, and Nas actually showed up to this event, which, you know, I was like, whoa. And everyone started, you know, asking him questions and interviewing him, and I had brought my little mini disc recorder to get what's called a drop, which is basically, you know, a cosign. It's him saying his name and my name and me having it on tape, and then, you know, I can put that on a mixtape. And I put my recorder down and recorded, you know, this entire interview, which was like an hour and a half. And somewhere in the middle of that, I was just thinking how amazing it would be to take that interview and mix it with his music and tell his story in his own words and music. And that became the first real, you know, one of these best of mixtapes that I did. And gave it to some friends, and, you know, a couple months later, a friend of mine from an underground hip-hop group called The Arsonists called me and said, you know, I'm in a barbershop in Bushwick, and they're playing your CD. And I told him to go check and see, and it turns out it wasn't my CD, it was actually a bootleg of my CD. And at that moment in New York, like, if your CD was bootlegged, like, that was really, really good, because that meant that people really wanted your CD, and that, you know, it was getting sold, you know, in the places where mixtapes were sold, on Canal Street and 125th Street. And so I literally, you know, once I got off the phone, I said, okay, I need to make more of these. And I found a manufacturer that could really, you know, duplicate a lot of them, and just started making them and giving them out. And a couple months after that, it ended up in the Source magazine, in what was called the Hottest Mixtapes. And it was kind of funny because, you know, I had never really imagined doing this in any way, you know, that would turn into a career. But I constantly found myself wanting to push the envelope of what was possible, and you know, here I am. So, so that's sort of the long and the short version of the story.
How is the culture? Well, I'm interested. You know, you're in New York at a, like, really intriguing moment in terms of, like, hip hop's development, late 90s. Mm-hmm. How is the, so can you describe that ecology of, like, not even just hip hop, but, like, mixtape culture in the late 90s? Because I know that's changed a great deal since, you know, over the last 10 years.
Yeah, I mean, I moved to New York in 98, so I was at kind of the tail end of that, and it definitely was changing. Mixtapes, you know, when I was a kid, I had only, you know, a couple that I got. Like, I got, like, a Mr. C tape, I had a Tony Touch tape. There was an LA DJ called Silver Surfer. I don't know what happened to him. I'd love to find him because he inspired me to, you know, to do this in some ways. But when I got to New York, it changed a little bit into something where a lot of DJs were using this as a platform to promote themselves. And so there was a lot of shouting and calling your name and just, you know, dropping bomb sound effects and not mixing. And because I loved hip-hop and you know, I loved combining, the way that hip-hop combines elements, you know, from all over the place, that wasn't what I wanted to do. You know, I wanted to do something that was a little bit more true to the spirit of hip-hop. So for me, like, at that moment in time, it was about piggybacking on all of the channels that had been created to get them out into the world, but putting out something that was a little higher quality product. Like, I wasn't necessarily in New York when, you know, Tony Touch and those guys were really, you know, doing their thing, but they sort of laid the groundwork, and a lot of people then came in, and it became something much bigger. And now it's, I mean, it's changed even more because of the internet, but that's a whole sort of separate conversation. But yeah, I mean, it's hard to speak to how it changed from the 90s until when I got there, but I can say that it's changed a lot, you know, from when I started to now, for sure.
I mean, you call these, and we will have them for sale later, mixtapes. And yet, you mess with the expectation of that genre in a lot of ways. I mean, they're not traditional mixtapes in the sense that you add a lot of material that doesn't necessarily have to do with the artist whose material you're mixing.
Right.
So what's so interesting about, and we'll hear some examples later, of the stuff that you do, and I'm curious if the Nas mixtape was also followed this, but mm-hmm. is that it's a mix of historical sources.
Mm-hmm.
It's tracks that maybe aren't readily available commercially, alternate takes, demos, that kind of thing. So mm-hmm. could you just talk, like, about your particular take on the content of your mixtapes?
Well, I mean, I would say, like, for me, I was always interested in telling stories. Like, I love telling stories. Like, I was raised, you know, with stories of one kind or another. And I think that, you know, for whatever reason or however it happened, like, these things started to become a way for me to tell a story about the artist. And then everything that happened after was really me, again, like, sort of pushing the limit of what I could do to tell that story. And it's sort of like, you know, partially an answer to his question, it was in part because of the way that mixtapes so prominently featured DJs who were screaming over tracks that I said, I'm not going to do that. And so it became a thing of whose voice can I use other than my own? And so it was about finding, you know, like the Nas sort of interview was the first step of it. But I mean, if you really go and you sort of trace step by step through them, you'll see it get more and more involved, like, over the course of the tapes, because I started wanting to find new and different ways to tell stories. And then, you know, in something like the Kanon mixtape, it was about using one person's story to tell another person's story and finding the bits and pieces of correlation between the stories, which could, like, elevate that newer artist maybe a little bit to the status of some of those previous artists. But in terms of the bits and pieces that I found, I really, like, one of the reasons I've been able to continue doing this long past the point where it made sense for me to do this for a living is that there have been these ways that the sort of stars have aligned to just lay things in my lap. And with the Nas mixtape, I have a friend who just so happens to have grown up in Queens with Akineli and Nas, and just so happened to have recorded literally cassette tapes of Nas when he was 14 years old in his basement. And he gave me that stuff. So the first track on the Nas mixtape is literally a cassette recording from my friend Dean, and that was unavailable anywhere else. And I realized something when I put that on the mixtape, and people were like, "Where did you get that? I wanted more of that. Like, I wanted more of that. Where did you get that?" kind of thing. And so then it became about just pushing. And, you know, part of it is, as a fan of the music, you know, spending hours and afternoons in record shops and digging, you know, when I was still, you know, DJing with records, you know, whereas I'm using Serato now. So then it became about scouring the internet. And before, it was about scouring the internet for downloads. It was about scouring the internet for things that people had put up for sale. So, like, when I did the Lauryn Hill CD, I had very limited access to Lauryn Hill. Like, I sort of, you know, turn the knobs to make it seem like it was much more intimate than it really was. It then became, you know, a real relationship. But I went online and literally sought out, I was ordering bootleg VHS tapes of interviews from guys in the middle of nowhere that just happened to like collecting bootleg VHS tapes, and ordering, you know, CDs from Japan of, you know, a concert that somebody recorded, and then, you know, recorded interviews, you know. And those a cappella interviews were like a gold mine, because it was something that no one else would be able to find. And, you know, I didn't lie and say that they were my interviews, but I also didn't advertise that they weren't. So, you know, and it's like a lot, like, I have a joke that there's a lot of this that's smoke and mirrors, you know, whether from a professional standpoint of making my operation, you know, look much bigger before it was, or, you know, just sort of tweaking and turning things to make it, you know, really fluid and feel like it's all, you know, something that was recorded on another planet, you know, that you can't get to, kind of thing. And that's sort of my own little, you know, I guess, obsession. And that's, you know.
Do you have any of that handy to play as an example, one of the interviews?
Let me see. I don't know that I have this. I mean, on here I have more stuff for DJing.
Because it's true, when you listen to it's a 2-CD set, and when you listen to it, there's so much of her talking and telling all of these stories that one just thinks, perhaps, well,
what I can maybe do is, let's see. I don't actually have what you played, like, on from the CD. Mm-hmm. Like, maybe I can yeah, just pop it in and play. Is a good example, because at the beginning of the second CD, and one of the things that I would try to do is really pull the story together by, let's say, there's a little clip of her talking about, Come On Baby, Light My Fire, I forget the name of the song, actually, off the top of my head.
Jose Feliciano's version.
Yeah, Lauryn Hill's version, that's on Miseducation. So she's talking about the inspiration for that came from The Doors' Light My Fire. And then she's talking about how she, when she was a kid, had access to all different kinds of music, like Jose Feliciano's version of Light My Fire. So, you know, what I then did is I said, oh, okay, Jose Feliciano has a version of Light My Fire. Let me go and find that. And then I went and dug that up and made that the backdrop for this part where she's talking about, you know, her inspiration. And so it's kind of like, without you necessarily realizing it, it's illustrating the story that she's talking about while she's talking about it, and makes it sort of that much more real. So that is this right here.
This is Long Yet. This is Long Yet. This is Long Yet. The J period. The J period. The J period. This is the best of Long Yet. The best of Long Yet. That was definitely intentional. You know, it was a song I wrote first, okay? And when I, after it was done, and I ended up putting it using a harpsichord, that's when I realized, wow, this reminds me, you know, of that Doors tone, and the hook sounded so perfectly in that. I grew up around a lot of music. I'm exposed to a lot of different stuff. I mean, like Spanish guitarists, who some people wouldn't even know. People like Gilberto and Jose Feliciano, and some people, you know, just a lot of different music. You know, The Doors, Light My Fire. I'm Jose Feliciano's version of Light My Fire. So, you know, it was music that was in me. And, you know, what I was trying to say, it just fit right in.
So, you know, that's the way something like that comes together. And one of the things that, you know, it's not necessarily something I advertise, but because I don't use my own voice on the CDs, I like to choose clips where what the person is talking about is actually what I'm doing also. So, like, it starts off, you know, with "This is the best of Lauryn Hill 2, and it kind of comes out of nowhere. And then she's like, oh, that was intentional. And she's talking about something totally unrelated. But for me, like, that's my comment on what I just did. And then when she, you know, at the end of it, when she says something about, I forget like the line that I just played.
It just fit right in perfectly.
So like that, when she's saying it just fit right in perfectly, that's like my little comment. And the funny thing is like, I'm only indulging myself when I do that, because like nobody's ever going to know that, but those are the things that make it
now.
Exciting for me. Yeah. So those are the things that I like adding in. It's like my own little secret thing that I slip in, so.
How were some of the things that you were talking about your time at Stanford,
mm-hmm.
and DJing? How were some of your experiences, I mean, even outside of just DJing at Stanford? So you were telling me earlier before we started this about your studies,
mm-hmm.
and how initially you thought you were going to go into education,
mm-hmm.
and you kind of went in a different direction. How is, nevertheless, much of what you were studying, your interest, part of, I guess, what you're doing right now
as
you're producing music? I mean, do you see yourself as a historian or archivist?
I mean, I'm... like, I don't have a high enough opinion of myself to think that, like, I'm a historian. Like, if somebody else says that about me, that's awesome. That's great. You know, like, that's something I can take to my folks, and, you know, both of whom are teachers, and say, you know, like, look, you know, like, this is good. But, and I think, like, at Stanford, it's sort of funny, but there wasn't really a major that encompassed everything that I was interested in, but they did have a program called an individually designed major. And so I ended up doing that, and I took bits and pieces of all of the subjects that I was interested in, which, as I was telling you, sort of in a funny little way is kind of like, you know, what I do now.
Right.
Like, I just took all of the little things that I was interested in and then put it together in a way, and I literally had to write, like, this whole explanation of why I wanted to do this, and, you know, it's a serious thing there, and have to sit before a panel and justify how all these courses make sense together. And so I think in that way, definitely. But I think also I've always been interested, and one of the things that, you know, Josh and I connected on when we met is I've always been interested in the way different cultures mix together. You know, my background is Jewish. My closest friends growing up were, you know, either Jewish or black. And when I got to Stanford, I really was going to do Jewish studies and African American studies. And then I realized that maybe these two things aren't really separate for me. Maybe I need to find a way to turn it all into one thing. And my honors thesis, which I wrote at Stanford, ended up being about multi, you know, cultural identity and sort of mixed race and mixed religious identity and sort of how to make those things live together in one person in a way that works. Mm-hmm. So I think in that way, like 100%. When I talk to my advisor from Stanford now, he jokes with me that, like, I spent 5 years studying this, and I've spent 10 years since living it, which in some ways is kind of true. And then, you know, I've even, just through, you know, doing music and getting to go the places that I've gotten to go, I've gotten to explore and you know, see other cultures that I never was, you know, introduced to before or, you know, knew anything about, so.
was, I'll say this, I'm going to call you a historian. I sent your the Michael Jackson series that he did. So I've sent that to my parents, right? Just because at times they felt like they couldn't really connect to hip hop just in general. And for them, they were taken aback by how you digged into the crates. Like for them, they were like, my father said to me, he was like, this is history. He was like, this is history. So my father will give you that credit as well.
All right.
You know, so you can take that to your folks.
Cool.
And there was one track that you particularly were
blown away by, right? Oh, I was telling you, right? one of the songs that just blew me away was the Michael Jackson's version of I Shot the Sheriff, Bob Marley and the Wailers song.
Not released.
No, not released. And that's, you know, that's from digging. Well, it's like now I also have access to other people, so I've been able to, you know, make friends with a lot of people that have way more stuff than I do, like Questlove from The Roots and guys that know what I'm capable of doing. So if I go and tell them what I'm working on, they slide me a couple treats. The I Shot the Sheriff thing actually came from the guy I did the CD with, DJ Spinna. As far as like Michael Jackson and Stevie Wonder and Prince, I don't know anybody that knows more about their music or has more of their music. And he like just opened the vault and gave me, the Jackson 5 actually did a variety show for a couple years in the early 80s. And the variety show consisted of them doing all these other people's songs. And one of them was Bob Marley, I Shot the Sheriff. And I love the fact that I like having a little, like my favorite hip hop when I was growing up is very referential. Like one group always refers to something that another person says, and it's about knowing those things. And so I try to do that on my mixtapes. So for me, finding Michael doing Bob Marley when I'd done The Messengers, which featured Bob Marley, was like, again, another one of my own little, you know, correlations. I like to, you know, whether or not, you know, this ends up being viewed as historical is not up to me, but I would like to think that I'm constructing kind of a canon of work, you know, that by itself, if you look at it, everything works, you know, together. It's different, but it all has the same flavor and things refer to each other and so forth. And there's lots of little inside jokes if you pay attention.
But where do you go? Because the archival sources, I imagine, have changed over time.
Yes.
As archives change. Where do you have any places that are your kind of go-to archival sources? I mean, can you maybe walk us through just some, or if you can even share them?
Yeah, no, sure.
You know, the places that are your kind of go-to spots to look for great clips or great pieces of speeches or...
One of the funniest things about the time that we live in now is that everyone has access to everything. So it's really about not necessarily knowing where to look, but having the interest in looking. So you'd be surprised. At a certain point in time in my, you know, my sort of mixtape career, it went from tracking people down, tracking records down, to just being like, I wonder if I can find this online, and just going online and literally following threads online until I find what I'm looking for, or just scouring through tons of material. Some of it is going the extra, you know, mile and maybe ordering DVDs, you know, about somebody. And then it becomes, for me, an educational project. Like, you know, if it's educational for other people, that's awesome. But, like, for me, my favorite part is that through the course of doing these things, I learned more about these artists than I ever knew. My image of Michael Jackson was like Thriller. You know, like, that's all I knew about Michael Jackson. And when I started doing this project as sort of a tribute to him, I started learning more about Michael Jackson as a person. And it's why I ended up calling it, you know, Man or the Music, because people kind of view him in one of those two ways. And I found some amazing stuff on YouTube. Like, I literally just go on YouTube and search Michael Jackson interviews and then just have the patience to go through it all, or Michael Jackson home movies, or maybe there's one thing I see here that you know, I'm reading in the credits for that, and then I want to go and follow that and find that. And some of it is just digging, you know. It's like the places I dig are different, but it's all just about going in, you know, and taking the time and doing it.
It's researching.
Yeah, basically. Yeah. I mean, it's researching, but it's researching something you're interested in, so it never feels like research.
Right. Right. How long did it take to make a mixtape?
at this point in time, it really depends. Like, the Lauryn Hill mix took me about 6 months. And part of that was also working with an artist to not just make the mixtape, but to make this, which is, you know, by itself a crazy, you know, collage. I really like to view these as sort of art projects. So, you know, to the extent to which I can find, you know, I most of these I actually use the same artist. He takes a lot of time. So that there's that, then that takes time. But the Mary J. Blige, which is like three CDs, and is probably the most epic thing I've done, took like 2 years. The Michael Jackson is kind of crazy because the night that he passed, I got a call from some record promotions guys wanting me to send them, you know, my favorite Michael Jackson records to send out to the DJs. And while I was pulling those records, I realized how many of them there were. And I literally stayed up all night that night and made the Michael Jackson mixtape. And it wasn't until the following year that I went back and gave it the treatment with the interviews and sort of fine-tuned it. But the mix itself I made in one night. The new Michael Jackson mixtape, Spinna and I, due to time constraints, made in about 3 days. And, you know, I mean, that's like 3 days really making it, and then there's, you know, maybe a couple of lingering days on either side. The most time-consuming one, I think, was probably the Mary, I think, was the most. But the Q-tip was really time-consuming because I decided that rather than just make a mix and put Tribe Called Quest songs on it, I wanted to get all my heroes to remake Tribe Called Quest songs. So I put out feelers, you know, like I sent out requests to, like, De La Soul and Questlove and Black Thought and Talib Kweli and, you know, a lot of people, Pharoah Monch, expecting to get like a couple back, and everyone agreed to do it. So that took time, just sort of getting those things. And, you know, the other thing is that these aren't just mixing existing pieces of music. A lot of these are creating new pieces of music, so I have to go into the studio and mix each one of those. And if you go to something like the John Legend project, which I can pull up and sort of show, that one was the most involved of any because the band, The Roots, actually gave me all of the session files for the album. So they basically said, here's the album, here's all the stems from the album, do with it whatever you please. And I was like, are you serious? Like, okay. So I went and I made like, you know, 15 new songs out of their songs, and that became the mixtape, combined with, like how you said, the historical elements. And I mean, one thing I'll say about the sort of historian side of it is that hip-hop, like, at its best, you know, I don't know, like, you know, no offense to this generation of you know, people, but I don't know that hip-hop is as historically minded now as it was before. That it used to be that I learned about jazz from flipping over hip-hop records and seeing what they sampled. And then literally, like, I didn't know anything about jazz growing up. And I learned about it through hip-hop. And so hip-hop to me was always taking the best bits and pieces of history and combining them in a way that just made them better. And so that's what I wanted to do with my mixtapes, and that's the way I try to, you know, I describe them as often as possible, is that they're like the last true form of hip-hop because there's no holds barred. I can take things from everywhere and put them together and, you know, and tell a story. And if I'm doing something where John Legend and The Roots remake a Nina Simone song, I'm going to go get the Nina Simone song, and then I'm going to weave it into, you know, the new one to show where it came from, so that when people listen to my mixtapes, they're going to go, oh, that came from there? Like, I want to go find out more about that. And then they can go, you know, if they're interested, off on their own journey with it, I guess.
And I think you reflect that also in terms of even who you work with. I mean, doing a mixtape with Big Daddy Kane, you know, CL Smooth, people who are, I don't know if people are aware of who these artists are, but these are like classic, like, MCs who I grew up on. So it's also nice to see that they're being reworked into kind of like the current kind of cultural nature, right, of hip-hop in general.
And these are, I mean, the guys like Big Daddy Kane are your favorite MC's favorite
MC. Exactly.
Like if you look at Jay-Z, like Jay-Z is 100% Big Daddy Kane mixed with maybe like some Rakim. And, you know, I'd say like he's probably like 3/4 Big Daddy Kane.
Very, right? Much so. That whole, I mean, yeah. Jay-Z's swag definitely, I mean, it comes from the kind of, like, when, yeah, I think of Big Daddy Kane was like the image of like cool black masculinity in like the late, early 90s. I mean, yeah, he was the guy.
I just wanted his robe.
Oh, yeah, the robe. and the cane.
Yeah. Nice. So it's one thing to like make mixtapes. It's another thing to then
work have the mixtapes commissioned by the artists or helped along by the artists. Mm-hmm. Could you talk maybe a little about some of the kind of how you met particular artists and how you negotiate relationships with artists when you're trying to make work that's your own, mm-hmm. yet it is telling an artist's story that they, I'm guessing, need to like.
Yeah. I mean, to be honest, it's actually quite simple. Here's my business card. You know, like, if you like that, and, you know, then I can do that for you. And it's, I mean, it didn't, obviously didn't start that way, but when I got to New York, one of the first things I saw about the way that the music industry works is that everyone is always asking people. And so I never wanted to be someone that was asking people for things. I wanted to be someone that was giving things to people, because that's the way you get them to answer the phone when you call. And so I literally started out, I would just make a ton of CDs and give them out everywhere and hope that it would come back to me. And like my most sort of treasured moments and the most amazing moments the whole time I've been doing this are when I meet people and, you know, maybe I gave them a CD at some point in time or gave it to their bodyguard or their manager or somebody. And then when I see them again and I go up and I introduce myself and they're like, oh my God, like you did that such and such CD. And like this has happened with like Mary J. Blige and Alicia Keys and like Pasta Noose from De La Soul and like people that... Like I was like, huh? Like you, like what? Like I just didn't really believe that they already knew, and it's something I think where maybe I don't know how to describe exactly what it is about the CDs that appeals to artists, but I think that the way that it's not self-serving and the way that it's really sort of in depth, and you know, one of the things that I do whenever I do these CDs is I interview the artists, and I always start off with the same question when I interview them, which is, take me back to your house as a child. What do you remember hearing growing up? And it's sort of funny, but it's like a sort of way of removing them from their stature and taking them back to where it started for them. And I've lost track of the number of very famous artists that have agreed to give me 10 minutes of interview time. And I start with that question, and 2 hours goes by like that. Like it's like they get transported to a whole other place. And so I think that there's an element of that, and the fact that I approach it from a musician's standpoint, I guess, or I try to. So when they hear it and they hear the care in it, they know that it's not self-serving. It's not like I need you for something. I'm doing something for them. And so what's happened is that, you know, this one, like the Lauryn Hill CD, because of how beloved Lauryn Hill is and how absolutely impossible to deal with she is, like that CD went all over the place and became this really treasured thing. So like I've lost track of the number of people that I met that know me through that CD, and I think that that says what I'm all about, you know, like it's way beyond what I ought to be doing. Like there's more time put into it than I probably got, you know, paid back for, but still, you know, like they hear something in it that lets them know what I'm doing. So every time I'm introduced to a new artist, all I do is give them a bunch of CDs and say, like, you know, I'll see you in a month. And if they listen to even one of them, they get the gist, you know. Right. So.
And now you ended up going not only just from doing, you're back as a DJ as well. So you ended up on tour with Lauryn Hill.
Yes, and that's been another really crazy aspect of it is that because of the way I approach the CDs, the artists actually learn something about me when they're listening to it. So when I did the Lauryn Hill CD, I literally like mailed one to her and got nothing back. I met her brother.
You mailed it to her or to her. The label?
No, I mailed it to her.
So you had that?
Well, one of the things that happened during the course of making the Lauryn Hill CD, which made it what it was, is that I met Rohan Marley, who is the father of her kids. And it was literally the kind of thing where I gave him a bunch of CDs, and it wasn't even these, it was like some dancehall reggae CDs and you know, some hip-hop mixtapes, and he was moving out to LA, and like a week later he called me and was like, you know, J.Period, I need some more of those CDs. And I was like, okay. So I sent him out CDs, and this was actually when I was doing Declare Yourself with Norman Lear. And so I was out here every month for like a week, and I got to know Rohan Marley. And after getting to know him a little bit, I said, you know, I have this idea for something I want to do. And he was like, I can't help you with that. It's not my thing. But here's her email. And he gave me her email. And the Lauryn Hill mixtape literally started with me emailing Lauryn Hill and getting shut down. Like I told her what I wanted to do, and she was like, no, thanks. And I was like, you know, like, all respect due, I'm going to do it anyway. You know, like, I'm just going to do it, and you don't have to be involved. That's cool. You know, but I'm doing it out of respect. And then again, you know, sort of by, through the deaf poets that I met doing Declare Yourself, I was invited to her sort of comeback performance on Deaf Poetry Jam on HBO. And I went to the taping of that, and I sent her an email earlier in the day saying, I'm going to be at this thing, my friends are there, you know, if it's okay with you, I'd love to get a drop from you. You know, this is Lauryn Hill with J.Period. This is the best of Lauryn Hill. And I went early, and, you know, some of this is just, like, stuff I've learned. Like, you know, I went early. I went and introduced myself to all the security guards. I gave CDs to all the security guards. I found my way in and out. I asked really casual offhand questions, like, how did the artist enter, you know, in here? And basically, I mean, and literally sometimes that's what it is. Like, I got that drop because I put myself between her and the door. And there was no way she was getting out without passing me. And then the crazy part was that there was a videographer with her who was filming a documentary about her who happened to be friends with some of my best friends, a group called Zion I from Oakland. And so when he and I saw each other and she saw us see each other, it was kind of like, oh, okay, maybe this guy's okay. And she said, what do you need? And I said, this is Lauryn Hill with J.Period. This is the best of Lauryn Hill. And she recorded it. She gave it to me. And they turned the corner and they left. And I put my headphones on and I listened to it. And I turned around to make sure nobody was looking. And I literally jumped up and down. And I was like, because I knew, like, that was the holy grail of drops. Like, nobody was getting that drop. And mixing that together with the interviews, I was able to create something that became a blueprint for all the rest of them, basically.
It's a great story.
Yeah, it's crazy.
And actually, in terms of that, you don't worry about kind of, you know, licensing and such.
Sure, I do. I mean, mixtapes exist in a very crazy gray area, you know, somewhere between legal and not legal. And it's even weirder when you think about the fact that I've gone from doing these sort of independently at a moment where they were actually bought and sold and you could get physical CDs still, to getting hired by the record companies to do these, to promote artists, which is a sort of like, you know, a quiet acknowledgement of the impact of these things. But the marketing department will hire me, but they don't want to tell the business and legal people that they hired me to do it. And so it really, I mean, it often exists in this weird gray area where I've done CDs, like I did a CD for an artist named Josh Stone that I got hired by EMI to do. And literally, like the last week before I was turning it in, somebody put the word mixtape in an email that was sent around internally at EMI, and boom, that thing got shut down, and I was not allowed to put it out. And the Mary J. Blige project became like a near-death experience for me because I got hired by Interscope, Universal, to do it. I did it. I turned it in. And when Mary heard it, her response was like, I don't want this to be a mixtape. I want this to be an album. And I was like, that sounds amazing. Let's do it. And it then went into the system at Geffen where I was having meetings back and forth with this, I won't even say his name, but somebody that is very high up there who was going to make it happen. And after 10 months of negotiations, it turned out it would cost them $1.7 million to clear the samples that I had used. So they basically shut it down. And I still think that was a really big mistake because I think you could make $10 million if you put one of these out in the store and sold it. Because it's everything, like everybody who loves Mary J. Blige, it's everything they want in one place. And when that happened, the marketing people that work for Mary said, oh, well, we're going to give it out at her Super Bowl party. So I said, okay, fine. They gave it out. I sent out an email blast about it. And literally that afternoon, that senior lawyer for the whole of Universal Music Group, who is not playing around, called me personally and was like, you know, are you responsible for this Mary J. Blige mixtape? And I said yes. And I said, do you know that you paid me to do it? And she's like, I'm going to have to call you back. And so it became this thing where Universal couldn't do anything to me, so they sent the RIAA after me, who I'm sure everyone in this room knows for, you know, killing Napster and so forth and so on. And then began this protracted legal, you know, issue, which cost me a huge amount of money just to deal with. You know, and I mean, not because they, you know, I had to pay any penalties, but when the RIA sends you a letter, the letter says for every instance of copyright infringement, it's a $150,000 fine, and this was 120 songs on three CDs, so it was basically like, you know, I'm screwed. and so when that happened, it really changed my approach. There are guys that are friends of mine, a famous DJ named Drama, who got arrested for selling mixtapes. And at that moment, was literally a month later that this happened to me with the Mary J. Blige thing. So they were like on the hunt for mixtape DJs. And I decided that I was going to take a step back from trying to make my money selling them and instead turn my operation into a marketing engine for promoting these artists. So the money that I make then comes from the labels. But it's this weird thing where, you know, now my sort of biggest struggle is finding a label who is willing and who understands this, because that's the tricky part. Like, the people, like the younger people at the labels are super excited about it. They love it. The older people don't understand it. And those are the people that you make the decisions. So it's been an ongoing struggle to try and find, you know, let's say a catalog company to give me access to the catalog and let me make this for real and put it out and sell it. And I've gotten very close, and I'm, you know, sort of in negotiations right now with a couple catalog companies to see who's willing to like take a shot. And it may be that like I have to find the seed money and do it myself and prove it. And you know, I can laugh at all of them because I know, you know, for example, like I've sort of tried to take a couple side routes toward, you know, to make this something that can, you know, make money without, you know, breaking the rules. And so I manufactured a flash drive, a USB flash drive that I sold the flash drive and I gave away all the music. And I partnered with a company that did this amazing packaging, and we sold, you know, we put them up on my site for sale and sold out of them in a week. I mean, like, they were gone. And I know, and I got an email from somebody, like, the point of what I'm saying is, I got an email from somebody that said, you know, I've been getting your mixtapes for free, you know, as long as I can remember, and there's no reason why I should pay $50 for a USB flash drive. But because you've been giving me your mixtapes for free for so long, I've become a fan of yours, and so I would pay money for whatever you do. And I feel like those are the type of people that I appeal to. You know, it's like you have to be a real fanatic to get into what these CDs are about. And so I really hope that, you know, when the time comes that I get somebody to agree to put one of these out, that it'll, you know, sell like hotcakes, and you know, we can talk about this on CNN. So,
do you want to walk us through?
Sure.
Not the most recent, but...
The Wake Up?
Yeah, the okay. Wake Up.
Do you want me to sort of show people or just play?
Yeah, let's plug in. So maybe set it up a little, what this is.
All right, so for the CD that I was talking about with John Legend and the Roots, I was hired by, John Legend's label, which is Sony, to do this project. The Roots already, because I did a similar thing for them in 2006, know, you know, what I do. Basically, like I said before, were willing to give me all of the session files for the album, and then allow me to make my own versions of all the songs. And then, because the CD is essentially, it's protest songs from the 60s and 70s that John Legend and the Roots remade. So, you know, like Bill Withers' I Can't Write Left-Handed, which was originally about the Vietnam War, John Legend and the Roots sort of made it about, you know, Iraq and you know, the war in Afghanistan. Not directly, but when you sing that song now, it takes on a different meaning for people that hear it. So what I wanted to do was to basically tell the stories of these songs both from the original versions and the original artists and the relevancy in that time to the new songs and you know, maybe the relevancy today, and then also weave in, you know, other elements to help tell that story. And the idea that I came up with, because every time I do one of these, I really, like, I force myself to try to do something different conceptually. And the idea that I came up with was, what if you had, I mean, we all listen to the radio, we know it's on the radio. So what if you had an alternate universe where when you turn on the radio, it was all, like, positive, socially conscious music. And it was inspiring, and it wasn't like, you know, I won't even get into it because you all know. You know, like, it wasn't sort of degrading, it wasn't any of that. And what would that sound like? So I came up with this idea of Wake Up Radio. And then it became about taking all the elements that exist on a radio station, you know, the drops, the host, people phoning in and you know, like making requests, and mixing that all together in a way that feels like its own little, you know, radio station from this alternate universe. So I went with this concept to Black Thought from the Roots, and he loved it. And I also, for those of you that have seen Do the Right Thing, Sam Jackson's character, there's a radio station that sort of, you know, peeks in and out, and Spike Lee uses it to tell some of the story through Sam Jackson as this radio host. So I decided that I would have Black Thought play the role of Sam Jackson on the CD. So let me see if I can isolate this. All right, so... So yeah, the other ingredient of this CD became me coming up with what Questlove called my soul bucket list, which is all the songs I would love to hear John Legend sing that he hasn't sung. So I sent them a wish list of, you know, maybe like 10, and got 5. The 5 that I got were Inner City Blues, Roy Ayers' Everybody Loves the Sunshine, the Beatles' Eleanor Rigby, because I have a Dilla beat that is actually sampling Eleanor Rigby or based on it, and then a song called In the Ghetto, which is originally an Eric B. and Rakim song. So the CD starts with the John Legend version of Inner City Blues.
One of my past lives.
And Black Thought doing this sort of, I imagined it as being, if I'm going to transport you to this other world, you know, this other world's radio station, that first I need to kind of like take you into that world. So the sort of first song is kind of setting the scene, I guess. And Black Thought is talking about all the things you would see in this, you know, in this world, in the inner city, and John Legend singing. And then from there...
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and good morning. This is John Legend and the Roots for J.Period. Wake up. So rise and shine. Open up those eyes. Open the curtains. Let the light shine in. Wake up, everybody.
So just to show you, like, you know, the elements that I use, like, there's... so this is one of them that I go back to a lot in the CD. Literally just like the sound of turning a radio dial, and then some kind of faint static in the background. With the drops that I had them record, I also put a sort of filter on it so that it sounds, you know, more like it's coming through a transistor radio.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and good morning. This is John Legend and the Roots with J.Period. Wake up.
And for those people, again, that know Do the Right Thing, that is actually Sam Jackson's voice. So it's like, again, one of my little, like, I just kind of slipped that in there for, it's like an extra layer of meaning, I guess, for people that you know, or maybe they'll one day, you know, hear it and go, oh man, like, I didn't know that was there. And then from there, So yeah, so in this part, John Legend basically plays the role of the radio host, and then I really only have him kind of at the intro, and then again at the end, and then at the end of that segment, it sort of goes into the, you know, the radio show, which is. So again, for those people that know Do the Right Thing, this is kind of lifted, like what he's saying is partially lifted from the movie.
We pay tribute to the legends of the past and introduce the legends of the future. Special big ups.
So another thing that I think is important that, I mean, most people don't know about when I do these is that it's not just about sort of figuring out how the pieces of the puzzle are going to come together, but I actually write all the scripts for everyone of what they're going to say, because, like, I really want it to be, you know, cohesive. And I can play, a great example of that. I want it to be cohesive, and I also have to record these things in a lot of different places. Like, I'm going up to the Jimmy Fallon set and, you know, getting 10 minutes with Black Thought before he goes out and getting him to record it there. I'm maybe, you know, sending a script to John Legend's manager, and then he's recording it, you know, wherever in the world he's doing his next show. And in other cases, there was something I wanted to do on this CD, which was have people call in like you would have on a radio show, but I didn't want it to just be anybody that was calling in. So I put out a request to have Common, be one of those people. But, you know, I didn't just want it to be like him calling in and sounding like he was reading a script. I wanted it to be like he was having a conversation with Black Thought, only I wasn't actually, like, getting them together in the same place. So I had to write a script for Common, and then I had to get Common to record it, and then I had to write, the other part of the script for Black Thought and go have him record it so that, you know, when it comes together, what you hear is this. Let's see. Maybe I'll just play with the music. And actually, just before I play this, one last thing about weaving the elements together, that when I go and I ask John Legend to do, you know, Everybody Loves the Sunshine, and I make a beat out of that original sample and elements of, you know, Marvin Gaye's Sexual Healing, where he's saying, wake up, wake up, wake up, because that's the name of the CD. I then go from there into a different version of the same song. So the music goes from... that's a later part of the CD. But the music goes from one version to the next version and tries to tell the story there. So here's this this thing with Common that I was talking about.
Once again, Black Thought, your boss DJ from around the way. It's time to hit the phones and hear from some of our listeners. Caller number one, state your name.
Yeah, yeah, is this Wake Up Radio? WAKE? Yeah, yeah. Common, I'm calling from the south side of Chicago. South side, baby. You know how we do, 87th Street, Coney Island, all around South Town. Alright?
Any message you'd like to give our listeners?
Yeah, I got a message, man. I got a message I definitely want to say is to all my people out there, man, spread love, you know, stay
cool. All together.
It's important for us, man. We want you to have it.
Another thing is, like, for anybody that's like an audio file or audio engineer in here, tweaking elements like is essential, because you can make it sound like it belongs together by EQing things in a way that is not possible, you know, if you don't do that.
Wake Up Radio. And I want to send a shout out to my guy, Jay Miller. You always with us, man. The greatest to ever do it. God bless your soul, man. You got it.
So here, at the end of the Common drop, I knew that I wanted to go from there into this J. Dilla version of Eleanor Rigby. So I actually had him sort of make a request for a J. Dilla song. So it's as if he's called into the radio station, and through the course of the conversation, you know, he's, do you have a request? Yeah, I want to hear J. Dilla. And then it goes into J. Dilla. So it's like, you know, it was all kind of laid out that way. And then for this one, before it goes into the Dilla version of Eleanor Rigby, like I never kind of assume that people know the history of these songs, just because I've been places where people hear an original and they're like, oh, that's such and such, and they think that the hip hop song was the first one that used, you know, that put it out, and that the original is actually sampling the hip hop song. So I really like to like put little bits in it that tell the story.
Okay, then by request, this next one goes out to the late, great J. Dilla and all the lonely people.
Wake Up Radio, hip hop is still alive. Keep on.
So it starts off with Ray Charles version.
Because the lights in the church where we're headed.
And then into Aretha Franklin version. And then to the Beatles version. then, like, you know, like, the best part of this, obviously, is when you hear John Legend come in, like, singing, you know, the original. So that's a little illustration.
That's like $1 million of licensing just in that 10 seconds.
Yeah, basically.
Beatles, Aretha.
I mean, yes, it is, but it's also, you know, potentially a lot of money in people purchasing those things that I've just introduced them to. And then that's the part of it that's sort of like the tricky part to convince a record label of, but I firmly believe to be true that, you know, in this day and age, if you want to get free music, you can get free music.
Right.
So you really want to appeal to the people that are the aficionados that are going to go and find it and want to pay for it. So
what's interesting hearing you when you kind of talking about what you have to do is we'd already talked about kind of the historical research component, but then there's the kind of curatorial component where you're making these really tough choices about what to include and trying to be original with it and specific and do something no one else has done and make conversations happen that never actually happened. But then the more I was listening to it, it sounded like you could have been talking, you know, as if you were a writer of radio dramas in the 1930s. I mean, that's really what these are in a way, is you're writing scripts for audio performances. I mean, it's what radio it's what radio used to be.
I did not know that.
Pre-TV. I mean, you know, I mean, it's like The Shadow or something. I mean, you're writing for voices. And then mixing that in through, you know, obviously the aesthetics of hip hop, and so it's fascinating. I think we should open it up and get some Q&A from you guys. If anyone has questions, comments,
okay. Is there such a thing as fair use, so that you can use a certain number of seconds before you have to?
Yes and no. I mean, like, the sort of my version of fair use is that we give these things away. Like, I don't sell them, and for all intents and purposes. That has basically made it possible for me to do these in a big way. I mean, I know that a friend of mine was another DJ and a very big DJ. His name is Jazzy Jeff. He did a Michael Jackson CD also. But Jazzy Jeff's CD, which was given away, had a companion t-shirt which could be purchased. And as a result, the Michael Jackson estate shut Jazzy Jeff down. Whereas, you know, like my thing is done... and I'm really always very careful about this, that it's done with respect to the artist, and it's also done in some kind of official forum. So my Michael Jackson CD, I was able to put it out because it was part of Spike Lee's Michael Jackson tribute party that he does in New York, and it's sort of on Spike, once Spike has co-signed what I'm doing, to, you know, he has a relationship with the Michael Jackson estate that's better than I could have. So in that way, you know, it's not actually fair use, so it doesn't really answer your question, but fair use is tricky because it only applies to certain things, and it only applies in certain ways. And one of the, I don't know, consequences or benefits of me doing this and the background that I have is I know more about music copyright law now than I ever thought I would or wanted to. And it came from being in a position where I had to be on the phone with lawyers that were literally charging $1,000 an hour, and they don't understand what I do. So I figured the easiest shortcut is for me to understand what they do, and that way, like, I can help move this along a little quicker. Because, you know, it's like, I'm not going to spend an hour with you charging me to explain to you what a mixtape is. Like, you know, just, like, tell me, you know, like, I'll write the letter, and then you tell me, like, how to change it to make it more official. So... that's been another one of the challenges here is I sort of feel like I've gone from wanting to do mixtapes to wanting to, you know, change the entire way of, you know, that these things are put out and can be put out. And it's very ambitious and, you know, who knows if I'll ever be able to do it. But, you know, copyright law is definitely a huge part of it. So
just one other quick thing. It just reminds me of the radio on a little bit of Fireside Theater.
Right, which is like interesting, yeah.
But what do you think about the fact there's a whole area of music that's developing around, like, the use of this music? I mean, music that you cannot sell because of all these copyright issues, but it's just like a whole...
Well, I think that the record companies, like, are hemorrhaging money and have been for a long time. And I think that there's one of two ways they could go about this. They could either realize that they could make money off of this, or they could just keep hemorrhaging money until they don't exist anymore. So, you know, like, this type of stuff is going to go on regardless of if I'm doing it. They try to make examples out of people like me. But any kid, and there's probably kids that grew up knowing this technology from an earlier age, yeah, that can do this better than I can, you know? And there's a gazillion of them out there. So, in a minute, there's going to be so many people doing this that it's not going to matter anymore. Like, everyone's going to be doing it. And we're kind of already there, you know? So I think that one person I know who is very high up at Geffen said that the record companies are so close-minded that they would sooner watch the ship sink than change the way they do business. And sometimes I feel like that's true. But there are, you know, independent-minded people. And, you know, in some ways it's about, like, finding somebody that wants to invest their money in something really interesting and do an experiment. And let's see if it works. And maybe they can afford to do that experiment. So.
How did you first gain contact with Questlove Group?
And can you hook Maxwell up?
I guess I got in contact with him. I mean, there was definitely a lot of me seeing him and giving him CDs before he knew who I was. But I think he was really impressed by what I did with the Roots mixtape, because that one, I had 2 weeks to do. And I had to extract from Black Thought, like, the bare minimum that I could get from him. And Questlove was really impressed with the way I put that together. So from then on, it's become like cooler and cooler and cooler. And again, it's like the kind of thing where with most of these guys, everyone that's coming to them is asking for something. So I just don't ever ask for anything. And now it's at the point where I don't have to ask. Like, he'll, like, you know, just kind of give me stuff. But I try to tread lightly with all of those guys, because I know that the reality of their lives is that they're always being pulled in a million different directions. So the best thing you can do is just be easy. You know, like, don't need too much and don't ask for too much. And get lucky, I guess. Like, yeah.
Thanks for coming, by the way. I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about maybe the evolution of the mixtape as a genre in itself, and where it started when you first started out, and where you think it might be headed to.
Well, I think that, I mean, where it started was that, in hip-hop, you know, there's something funny that's happened, which is that for the most part, the MCs are the famous people. And it's probably because they're in the spotlight, and they're at the front of the stage, like the way lead singers are famous. But in the early days of hip-hop, the DJ was actually the star, and the MC had to ask permission of the DJ to pick up a mic. And so, you know, in that era, there was a sort of group of DJs that were born that were the authorities, and the sort of next generation still had a little bit of that in it. So it was like, you know, Ron G and Kid Capri Red Alert. I mean, another one. And what happened was that back then, the DJs were the people that everyone would bring their music to. If you wanted your record to break, you would take it to a DJ. And so the DJs had all the best music before anybody else did, and it became just a platform for getting your music out. And I actually had a guy who, I don't know if anybody in here knows, named Fab Five Freddy, who was, like, you know, Yo MTV Raps, like, original host, tell me that he actually took Kid Capri and the first, like, mixtape ever, you know, up to Harlem to a store and sold them on the idea that this was a good thing because the DJs were an authority. And so, you know, I think that back then it was about, you know, the DJ as that authority. And then it changed, because I think what happens anytime, it's like in New York, a club never lasts more than 3 months, because as soon as people find out that's the hot club, everybody goes there and then the club sucks. And it was that kind of thing with mixtapes, where everyone saw that you could get famous off mixtapes, and then everyone wants to be a mixtape DJ. And then it's more about being famous than about, you know, making a real mixtape. And now I think what's happened is that a lot of those guys have died off or gone in other directions. Like, I know mixtape DJs that are like, you know, and people that are my friends, so, like, I'm not to disparage them, but they're like hosts on the E Channel. You know, like, they're just like, use that, they parlayed that somewhere else. And for me, like, it was never really about that. Like, it was always about taking the best music and putting it in one place. Like, my sort of huge secret of doing this is that I never make any of these for anybody else. I make these the way I make them because I want to hear them that way. And it's like, if you were in high school with me and we were driving around, I used to annoy the hell out of my friends because I would literally drive with the CD book on my lap. And I would play one song and take it out and I would put in another song. And I just always knew what I wanted to hear. Like, after every song, maybe I want to hear something else. And so, like, what's happened now is that you know, the internet is in some ways like the great equalizer, because like things, you know, have to get passed around virally, which means that you have to like it enough to give it to your friend. And so it has to be good enough for you to want to give it to your friend. And so I think that now it's kind of leveled off where there's a few DJs that really get passed around, and then there's a lot of people that are doing whatever they're doing in their own little corner of the world, and you know, maybe people will find out or maybe they won't. And I tell the same thing to people who ask me like about a career in the music business, like don't do it for fame and don't do it for money, like do it because you love it, because otherwise it's not worth it. Like it really, like the work you have to put in has to come from your passion for it. So, you know, my hope is that now, at, you know, at this era, where a lot of mixtape DJs, some of them have gone on to make albums, and you find that the albums don't sound like the mixtapes because they have to abide by a different set of rules. So for me, like, I really would like to be the one that legitimizes this thing. Like, I would, you know, I would like it to be something that people take seriously and realize there's a whole genre here that, you know, could be a commercial genre. But I think the fate of mixtapes is the same fate as music on the internet. You know, it's just kind of like, it's so wide open that it's impossible to predict. And there's a whole other generation of people that could take it to a place maybe that I can't even imagine. So I don't know if that answers the question, but.
Right, we have more tools now than ever. I mean, you know, it's a kind of, beyond a hip-hop generation, it's a playlist generation where,
yes,
you know, when we were growing up, the idea of easy, to put together a pause tape took, mm-hmm, a lot of work,
mm-hmm,
and you had to have the CD book in your lap, on, you know,
yeah,
while you're driving, versus now playlists are how everyone listens. So
yeah,
you're always curating, you're always creating mixes. So there's a big gap, I think, from when you started to how people are making mixes now.
I think one thing I would say about now, which I also believe, is that because the sort of playing field is so wide open and level, like what you find is people get lost really easily and they need a tour guide. So like in a lot of ways, like the way that you would go to that DJ in the beginning days as an authority, I think people go to DJs now as authorities and on, you know, guiding them through all of this mess. Like there's so much music, like you could get lost in it and never realize about this amazing stuff that's out there. So, I mean, that's my hope. Like I see, you know, my future as being that. But. Cool. In the back.
Hi, I'm a big fan of the word.
Oh,
my question, I've heard you talk a little bit about the way you construct mixtapes is wanting to tell a cogent story from beginning to end. I know in my tradition and in your tradition as well, religious practice, that storytellers are really important. And I wonder which of the stories you're interested in telling next and how you go about constructing the story. So.
Good question.
Thanks.
An excellent poet, by the way. I would say that, I mean, definitely, you know, it's kind of funny. I was in synagogue for Yom Kippur, you know, just a day or 2 days ago. And there's so much in there about stories. And I couldn't help but think, like, that this, some of this has to come from there. You know, like, it has to come from me being raised with all of these stories. But I think as far as, like, where I want to go and the type of stories I want to tell, for me, I just want to continually tell a different story. Like, I want to tell a story that exposes people to a world that they didn't know about. And in the process of telling that story and learning, you know, about that world, I also get introduced to things that I did not know about. That I think for me, it has to be continually educational in the process and in making these things, because otherwise I'll get bored. But I think, like, long term, the type of stories that I like to tell are most about bridging the gaps between different cultures. I guess, you know, that was always something that I was very interested in. And I think hip-hop is the best, you know, at its best, is the best genre to do that in, because it really consists of a million different, you know, forms. Like, sometimes, like, I get into arguments with people, like, that are really cynical, like Questlove, who believe that music is changing and going in a different direction. And I think that hip-hop, you know, as much as it can get twisted and turned into the things you think are hip-hop on the radio, I think hip-hop can never be destroyed, because it's like a Frankenstein of everything, you know, like it's like all of bits and pieces of everything come together to make hip hop. So it might change and it might, you know, go somewhere else. But for me, it's always going to be the best medium to tell those stories. And you know, like whatever they are, like as long as they take me to different places that I've never been before, I think that's what I'm trying to do.
Hi,
I have a, I noticed your music and your work has a really old school feel, which is really good because hip hop nowadays is just the same thing, just repackaged with someone dropping a verse and everyone gets hooked on it. But how do you feel about artists like Apathy or self-titled in the underground hip hop movement in New York, which their music's really good, but a lot of people don't know about it? Is that something you'd be interested in promoting?
I we were talking before about a friend of his, actually, which I didn't know, is a guy named Homeboy Sandman in New York, who's an underground rapper. And it's like, as soon as I heard his music, I was like, this guy's got it. You know, I don't know what it is, but he's got it. And for me, it's about, there's a lot of artists Apathy self-titled, a lot of underground hip hop artists in New York, that some of whom I like, some of whom I feel like I can't necessarily relate to. And they're more specific, but there's guys Tech N9ne, who's super independent, but now huge, and Atmosphere, who are also super independent, but huge. And what's interesting about the two of those that are the biggest and best examples is that rather than trying to get a record label to put their stuff out, they built their own record label, and they built their own engine. And, that became the best vehicle for promoting their stuff and spreading the word about it. And with a lot of underground artists, I find that I can't work with an artist unless their music really appeals to me, in a lot of different ways. And so, sometimes I'll get approached by people to do stuff, and I might like their music, but I might not feel like I have a way to take that from here to here. And so, another thing that I've talked with people about is actually, creating my own platform so that I would have an avenue not just for promoting those people through mixtapes, but co-signing them and putting them out, through my own label, basically. Apathy and Self-Titled have been around a long time, but there's a lot of newer guys. There's guys like Blue out here in LA who I love. As far as I'm concerned, he's the best rapper I've heard in 10 years. He's amazing. And there's a lot of other guys like that. And some of those guys, I want to do mixtapes with, and Blue and I have been talking about doing a tape for a while. But, it also comes down to, me getting to a point in my life where, I need to turn this into something that isn't just in my spare time. Something happens when hip-hop goes from being your hobby to being your career, and, I can't do everything for everybody. So, if it makes sense, then I do it. Or in the cases of some artists, there's a girl named Nitty Scott in New York, really good young female MC, and for her, I just did one remix, and so that remix became something that she blasted out. And what's funny about it is in the internet era, and on blogs, it's just about having something at the top of the blog. It's just about having something. It doesn't matter what it is. It could be a video, it could be a whole mixtape. I could have spent a year on it, or I could have done a remix in a weekend. But as long as it's blasting out, it's getting them exposure. So I'm trying to do that more with artists like that.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you so much for your talk. I had kind of a question you touched on a lot in your discussion about the influence of technology, particularly because your career has kind of taken shape along all of these really big changes in technology that affect the music industry. So I was just wondering if maybe you could kind of talk a little bit more about that.
I couldn't do what I do without the internet. There's no way. I never would have had a platform to send things out all over the world. It wouldn't happen. I got to go to Tokyo, Japan last week to DJ because they know about my mixtapes because they know about them from the internet. And it's kind of insane if you think about it. That there's this vehicle for sending things all over the world that if it's appealing enough to people can then send you to those places as well. So, and really for me it's sort of funny, but it's whether it's the really good color printer, that I started out printing my stuff on, or CD burning technology, or the internet, the rise of the internet in the moment that I went to New York, or learning about those audio softwares in those early days. You can do things on a computer now that you just couldn't do before. Right here, I could make my album with this. That's crazy. It before would cost hundreds of thousands of dollars. And in some ways, back to the question that was asked before, that's part of what levels the playing field. It's also part of what makes a lot of crappy music. But, anybody with a laptop can make music. So you know, technology has been linchpin. Like, I couldn't have done any of this without technology, for sure.
Would you ever consider, or have you ever thought about partnering with an MC to make a duo like Gangstar, Pete Rock, and Salesman?
Yes, actually, I have. His name is Black Thought. But we'll see how that goes. No, I mean, like...
You've been doing shows.
Yeah, we've been doing shows. I a couple years ago came up with this concept called the live mixtape, which is basically taking what I do on the mixtapes to the live stage and taking it around to different places. And I used to do this, and still sometimes, with a lot of different artists from the 90s and have them come out and do one song, and then the next guy would do one song. And then I got asked to do this with Black Thought in Toronto 2 years ago, and something really crazy happened, which is that I realized that I don't need all the rest of those MCs, because Black Thought is amazing, you know? Like, even to the point where he does impersonations of other MCs. And so we started touring this around, and we've done probably 20 shows in the last year and a half, and we'll continue to do more. And he is someone that I would like to do an entire album with. But I also know that, you know, the roots are the roots. So that has to happen at a specific moment in time, in the right moment in time. Until then, my album will consist of all the people that I've done all of these things with, hopefully. So.
One more? Last question.
I was wondering, like, we haven't exactly talked about how you make the music in terms of, you came from like a DJ background, mm-hmm. tables, I guess. Now, are you doing everything digitally? Or do you record live what you spin? Like, what's the process? What's the workflow for an album?
Okay. That's a good question. It's changed a lot for sure. You know, with the Nas, it was like turntables, recording it into the computer. You know, one take, you better get it right. and then going and layering things on top of it. I used to use a really rudimentary software to do this because I was on a PC. Like, I just switched to Macs like maybe two, three years ago. And it was called Sonic Foundry Vegas. What's that? It was Vegas Acid and SoundForge, and like through those three things I would do various things. So like one program I would use to layer sounds and, you know, add the interviews or whatever. Acid I would use to like take loops and chop them and make tracks. So like I could play some of this stuff, but like on the Roots mixtape, I took the Beatles Come Together and made a beat out of that. And I don't know if that's feedback. So I took at that stage I was using an MPC 2000 to do the drums and recording it in, you know, literally like stem by stem, and then once you get it in, you know, mixing it. As time has gone on, my software has changed. Like, now I use Ableton Live, like that's like the main tool that I use, and I love it. Like, it's awesome. And then a device called Machine by Native Instruments, which is basically a version of the MPC, the drum machine, that's connected to the computer via USB, and is already like, I can drag and drop. So like, I can make my beat here, and I can literally drag it as stems into Ableton. So it's like, what used to take me 2 days takes me 15 minutes. Like, it's crazy. And, you know, when it comes to just like the content of the mixtapes, I also, you know, produce music, and some of the stuff that I've done, you know, which has kept me doing this, is producing original music or remixes for movie trailers, for video games. Like, I did a whole Tony Hawk soundtrack for one of those video games, and I was in DJ Hero. Like, I did stuff for that, and I've done a couple. Like, I did a track that was in American Gangster, the movie trailer, and then a movie called Street Kings also. And with those, like, that's more original composition or sample-based stuff. So it's taking a sample, you know, recording it in off of vinyl for the most part, because I still like the way that sounds. And then, you know, in a program like Ableton, what I can do, and you know, and I wish I could have shown, but what I can do is I can lock it into a tempo and I can stretch it so that I could take something in one time signature and change it to another time signature to make a, you know, a beat out of it. And then I can do the drums, and then I can, you know, like I said, like drag and drop those layers in. And I'll have a bass player come over and play bass. I have a keys player who, you know, with his keyboard can make any instrument sound. And then I have a guitar player. There's a group, really, really good group, like punk rock, hip hop group called Game Rebellion in New York. And I did a mixtape for them, actually. The guitarist from their group is named Yohimbe. Like, I'll have him come over and record, you know, just kick ass, you know, like heavy metal guitar. And there's things that I can do. And, you know, one of Russell Simmons' like best lines ever is that the secret to success is knowing your limitations. So it's like knowing what I can do and knowing what I can't do. So like, I have a good ear for pitch and sound, and I know when things sound right, but I'm not a virtuoso, you know, on any instrument since my saxophone, which I haven't played in, you know, 20 years. But so it's about layering those elements together. And really, like, I'll say, like, if you're interested in making music, like, the secret is listen to a lot of music, because over time, the way you listen to it will change. And in some ways, it's frustrating because I can never listen to music. Well, actually, that's not true. There's certain music that sounds like it, like, dropped from the sky, and it's perfect. Like, you listen to, like, Michael Jackson Thriller, like, I literally can't dissect what's what in those songs. It's just perfect. It all sounds great together. There's other music where you can hear the different instruments and layers, and if you start to, like, break down what happens to your energy level based on what's going on with the music, you start to learn about how to make your own music. And now, like, all of those things become seeds in me making my own music. And, you know, where I can't do something, I'll get someone to play or whatever. But what I'm good at is taking all of those things and combining them in a way that sounds, you know, genuine or, you know, authentic. So, you know, for me, when it comes to the mixtapes, it's about, like I showed you, you know, telling the stories and taking those archival elements and all this, you know, found elements. And now it's about doing that. And the bed of music, instead of just being other people's stuff, is my own versions of their stuff. So, like, that's why, like, the John Legend one was such an accomplishment for me, because it's not a mixtape. It's actually, it is an album. It's 15 new songs that each of which I made, I produced the drums for, I had some recording in instruments. I then mix each of one of those songs individually, which by itself is its own process. And then once each of those is done, then I can go and tell my story, you know, with those elements. So it's like a whole other dimension of it when you're trying to make your own music. But, I mean, ultimately, you know, if you want to do music professionally, you have to make your own music. It can't just be about you mixing other people's music, unless you're like Tiesto and you make $50,000 for DJing some stadium. Like, you know, that's not me. So what appeals to me is not what appeals to, you know, 50,000 people buying tickets, at least not yet. So, you know, for me, like, it's about making my own music and making that a part of these projects. And the last thing I would say is, it's also about knowing when not to mess with it too much. So, like, with the Q-tip thing, like, I'm not going to make my own version of Tribe Called Quest songs. Like, those are sacred. Like, I got the instrumentals. I gave them to the MCs. They recorded it. I mixed it to make it sound as close to the original as possible, and I'm done. So,
cool. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks for being here. Thank you.
What happened to the...
We've got boxes.
I mean, either way.